episode 126, Oodles about Google. Welcome to Gratitude Geek, the relationship marketing podcast helping micropreneurs find your micro influencer magic. I'm your host, Kandas Rodarte, and this week I'm joined by Brandon Leibowitz. Brandon runs and operates SEO Optimizers, a digital marketing company helping small and medium-sized businesses rank in Google for hyper-competitive keywords, increasing sales and generating new business. He has over 14 years of digital marketing experience specializing in SEO and social media marketing. Welcome, Brandon.
Thanks for having me on today.
So tell us your story. How'd you get to where you are?
Well, I kind of just fell into this whole digital marketing sphere after I graduated from college, got my degree in business marketing. And the first job I got was they wanted me to do SEO. And I didn't really know much about SEO. They didn't really teach much about that. This is back in 2007. And they said, don't worry, we don't know much about it either. Just kind of interesting. They're like, we'll take you to classes and workshops and kind of learn with you. So did that for a few months and kind of just realized that I feel like everyone's going to have a website in the future, and SEO is a way to get free traffic. Cause I was helping out with their social media. I was doing paid ads. I was doing email marketing. I'm doing it all, and just realized that SEO, like, why spend money on paid ads when I could get you up there for free? So ever since then, I've just worked at different advertising agencies, helping out mom and pop shops and Fortune 500 companies and everything in between with their SEO, and always worked full time, but realized that also you could do this as like freelance work and kind of pick up clients here and there. And over the years would do that while working full time and built that up to enough where I was able to make the same amount that I was making at the advertising agency. So quit my job a few years ago just to really focus on the SEO, help out a little bit with the paid ads and social media, but really prefer that organic free traffic.
I love that. So 2007, 2008, that's about the time I sold my web hosting and design business. I decided when CSS became a thing that I didn't want to learn another language. So I sold the business. Plus I had other things going on. So a lot has happened since then. I mean, I started that business. I actually purchased it from someone else in, I don't know, about 2000. And between 2000 and 2008, it changed dramatically. And since 2008, multiply that by a million. It's so different than it used to be. And there's so many people in that space doing different things. But what I think is true, and you can disagree with me, is that the fundamentals haven't changed. You want people to find your website. In order to find your website, you got to do certain things. So talk to me about that.
Yeah, no, definitely the fundamentals haven't changed. It's just how you implement it. Like, Google changes their algorithm pretty much every single day. They're changing it up. Social media, there's always new sites that emerge or disappear. And there is no constant with digital marketing. It's always changing. It's always evolving. And just trying to stay up to date with all the latest changes and trends and just constantly just reading up, testing, seeing what works, what doesn't work, because you never know until you try it out. You can read all these strategies. You could listen to all these strategies on podcasts, on YouTube, but until you actually try it out and test it, you don't know if it's going to work or not. So because everything changes and what works today might not necessarily work tomorrow. It should for the most part, but Google's constantly changing. But the fundamentals, like you said, like having a good quality website, making sure it's easy to navigate, easy to find the product or service, have a good call to action. That stuff remains the same. It's now like, all right, is it on desktop? Is it on mobile? Is it going to be on some other form of viewing in the future? We got to adjust and adapt to all that stuff.
So one of the things that changed, I think I can't even remember when Google came out, but one of the things that changed with internet marketing was Google. They came on board and they dominated, and everything after Google was about Google. I mean, it just all the other search engines didn't matter anymore after Google, and it happened pretty rapidly. So why do you think they've dominated the market for so long?
Yeah, that is an interesting one. I'm not too sure. I think it's probably because it's just simple. You go to Yahoo, there's too much clutter on there. There's too many distractions. Whereas Google, you're just going on Google to search. They don't really give you many other options. They have all these other things, but they keep them separate. They're not like, where's Yahoo? You go on Yahoo. There's a search engine. There's mail. There's news. There's so much going on. It kind of distracts you. So I feel like that might have been it. But also, their algorithm was based on backlinks. So that was one thing that was a big change, is instead of ranking websites, however the search engines were doing it back before then. But before then, they were looking at like keywords and other factors. But Google said, we want to see backlinks. We want to see other websites talking about you. So it kind of became like a popularity contest. Like the more websites that talked about your website, the more trust Google would give you and the higher you'd rank in Google. Still heavily based off backlinks, their algorithm to this day, it's just changed a lot how they look at them. It's not a numbers game. Like in the past, if I had 100 backlinks and you had 200 backlinks, you would rank higher than me. Now it's not necessarily the number of backlinks, it's the number of quality backlinks. And what's a quality backlink to Google? To Google, they just want websites that are related to you. So finding niche related websites, so not just finding any random website, but finding a website that's related to you. And also the authority, like how popular or how big is this website? The bigger the website, like the LA Times or New York Times, is gonna pass on a lot more SEO value than a backlink from my website. My website is fine, but it's not the same as like an entrepreneur or some of these big corporate websites. So the bigger the website, the more SEO value and the relevancy, making sure it's from a related website.
That was the perfect lead into this next question. So something that you offer that a lot of folks don't offer is press releases. And you're just talking about how, you know, the New York Times or the LA Times or, you know, Entrepreneur Magazine has more authority than my website or your website is going to have in terms of a backlink. So press releases, therefore, are extremely important. So talk to me about press releases.
Well, press releases are just another way to build backlinks. It used to work a lot better in the past. Nowadays, it's not the most effective because, like I said, like relevancy is so very important. So you're getting on a site like Forbes or New York Times or LA Times. They're all good sites, but they're not about any specific topic. They're just general news sites. Relevancy is really the biggest thing, is trying to get on niche related sites. So that's a bigger aspect nowadays. But press releases, I mean, any normal business is going to do a press release or has done a press release in the past, like big corporate websites, they all do PR. So that's just a way to get more visibility and exposure. But the backlinks, they don't really help out as much as they used to in the past. So it's not really the most beneficial for SEO, but it does help out for local. Like if you're a local business, Google's algorithm for maps is heavily based off consistency of your name, address, and phone number. So the more places your business name, address, and phone number is listed on the internet, the higher you're going to rank on Google Maps. So press release is an easy way to get your name. It's called NAP citations, because your name, address, and phone number is always in a press release. So you write a press release, distribute it, get out there. Google's going to see that you're listed on all these different websites, and that's going to help out with the local rankings. It doesn't help out too much with the organic anymore like it used to in the past, but there's tons of websites that you could use to distribute press releases, like PR Web or iNewsWire or all these other paid submission sites where you just pay them and they get you out there. That's why press releases have kind of devalued in backlinks, because anywhere where it's too easy to get backlinks, Google's just like, we're not going to have this. Like Wikipedia, stuff like that, where you just go in and make changes, all those don't really count. Social media doesn't count because it's just too easy to get a backlink. So the press release, most of those sites are nofollow, where they don't actually count those backlinks, but it still helps get more visibility. Any way to get your name out there is always a good thing, as long as you're doing it by Google's terms of service. You're not doing like spammy stuff like that, but writing a good press release about something newsworthy or topical that your business is doing, like if you had a new product line or if you're doing a sponsorship at an event or whatever, might be newsworthy. But that's where you got to get creative and think about a unique way to pitch it.
So it sounds to me like it's more of a local thing.
It helps out with that. It's also okay, like a normal business like Target, Walmart, Costco, they're all going to do press releases. So it's not bad to do them. It's just kind of like fluff backlinks, where it's like in the past, these would really help you out, moving you up the rankings. Now it's just, it's okay. They're not bad. They're not good. It's kind of like a neutral backlink, where it's just like a normal business would be getting some of these websites or doing a press release.
Well, when you do a press release, you're controlling the narrative. You don't do a press release, you don't control the narrative, and they can report on whatever they want about your business. But when you control the narrative, they're basically regurgitating what you said. I can't tell you how many articles were written about my previous company where they just copy and pasted our about me page and, you know, just regurgitated everything that was in that page. I'm not doing that to criticize the journalist. I'm saying that I controlled the narrative, right? I controlled the narrative by giving the journalist the information that they needed. Okay, so you talked about maps. Maps is really important, and so is Google business profile. They kind of go hand in hand. What I want to know is, I've heard about this strategy where you are a content creator for Google Maps and you take pictures of restaurants and you put them out there on Google Maps. Is that a good SEO strategy?
If you're trying to become like, I know Google has all these different levels on, it's like Google Guide. So the more, it's like Yelp, becoming like a Yelp elitist, like the more pictures, the more reviews that you leave, the higher you move up in these rankings. So you could do that for your own self if you're trying to like just build up your guide. But for your business, you want to put your own pictures up there. So you want to take pictures of your products or service, but you don't want to just upload them to Google My Business or Yelp. You want to put them on your website or put them on your desktop first. Rename the files because that's so very important. Google can't read images yet. They're trying to, but they're not there yet. They need the file name. So whatever the file name is, that's really important. Then you can even right click on the image when it's on your desktop and go to properties. And then they give you even more settings where if you're a local business and you took a picture and your picture is in a different state, there's like there's all these settings in these images that you don't know about that you could change the radius and latitude and longitude and all these different things in there, all these different settings that will help you really optimize that image, because images, it's tough for the search engines to read them yet. They're trying to, they're getting better, but they really rely heavily on us kind of giving them that extra data, all this metadata.
This is new. No one has ever told me this before. So give me some examples of how you would rename that file.
So if it's an image, like if you're an Italian restaurant in Los Angeles, you can name it Italian-food-los-angeles.jpg or .png or whatever file name, but you put in like keywords in it. So Los Angeles Italian food or Italian food in Los Angeles or Italian restaurants in Los Angeles, because you don't want to name the image the same. Like if you have 10 images, you don't want to name them the same thing, because then you're just cannibalizing yourself. You're becoming your own competitor. So you want to rename them different words, doing the singular and plural, putting synonyms, restructuring the order. So some of them might say Los Angeles restaurant for Italian food, or another one might say Italian food in Los Angeles. So just trying to mix it up as much as possible. You can even put zip codes in there. Sometimes that helps out a little bit for local only.
That's brilliant. So what about like lasagna Italian restaurant, Los Angeles?
Yeah.
Spaghetti.
Or if the picture is, so you take a picture of the lasagna. So you don't really want to just put keywords to put them in there. But if it's a picture of a plate of lasagna, you could say like lasagna Italian food, Los Angeles, or lasagna Italian restaurant in Los Angeles or something like that. So as long as it's about that, you're not just spamming, just put keywords in there, you'll be okay. Because Google's seen people try to trick them over the years with that.
Listener, I want you to take note. This is probably the most valuable piece of information you've heard on this podcast in a long time. Change the name of your files before you upload a photo to Google.
Yep.
It's brilliant. Oh my gosh. Okay, so.
Not even it too. Like your podcast, anytime you upload the podcast file onto whatever platform, videos and images and audio files, like Google or all the search engines, they can't really read that yet or understand it. Like even if you upload a video to YouTube, they'll try to transcribe it, but they're not there yet. They still get a lot of it wrong. So the more you help them out, the better with all that stuff. So file name, so very important for all that stuff.
That's one of the reasons why I don't encourage people to use podcast hosting services where their file isn't owned by you, that somebody else creates, you know, the file is owned by somebody else. I always edit my ID3 tags, which is the same thing as editing the photo, you know, the photo name and all that. I always edit my ID3 tags so that they're completely complete, so that when Google reads my podcast file, they know exactly what it is. And I don't think you can do that with some of the all-in-one packages that are out there. It's the same concept. Okay. So let's go back to this, Google My Business, Google Business Profile, Google Maps. Mm-hmm. Is every business eligible for Google Business Profile? Or who should be doing it?
Well, for the most part, everyone except for maybe like e-commerce. You don't really see e-commerce businesses on there, but if you're a service-based business, even if you're like myself, I'm an SEO company. I'm in Los Angeles, but I could help people all over the world. So I put myself there as a service-based business. You don't necessarily need to put your address if you don't want to. You could just put your city and state. A lot of people are like, I don't want to put my address up there. You don't need to. I mean, initially, you need to get a postcard mailed to you to verify that you are actually at that physical location. But after that, you can go into the settings and hide it. Same with Yelp and all these platforms. So you don't necessarily need to put your address out there, but you want to put your business name, your city, state, your phone number, and consistency is really, really important across the board, making sure everything's 100% accurate.
For the folks listening who don't really understand what Google Business Profile is, give us a brief synopsis of what it is, and then let's talk about what kinds of things should go on it.
Google My Business Profile is Google Maps. So when you're searching on Google Maps or even on Google, sometimes the maps will appear. And if you want to go there, or if you're a local business, you could create an account, get verified. They're going to mail you a postcard to make sure that you really own or have a location there. They don't want you to just verify any place because people just go crazy and spam it all. So they're going to mail you a postcard. They'll give you a little verification code. You put that in. And once it's verified, then you could have full control of that listing and you could add images. You could add all these details about your hours and your like contact information, service areas, things like that. But when you're filling it all out, you want to fill it out as much as possible. If it says write 200 words about your business and you only write 100 words, you're missing out on an extra 100 words of space because Google's algorithm is really based off content. Like I was saying earlier, like images, videos, all that stuff, they can't really read them. They can read the file name, but they can't really read more than that. So text is what the search engine really feeds off. The more content you have on your website, the better off you're going to be. The more content you have on Google My Business, the better. The more content you have on like YouTube, if you transcribe your videos, even better because it's just, they feed off content, off text. The more text, the better. So fill that out as much as you can.
I never did the YouTube will transcribe your videos for you. And I never did it. I just didn't do it. I didn't think it was important. And then my aunt told me that she always turns on closed captions because she wants to read while she's listening because she's hard of hearing. And so I started to do the closed captioning, I just turned it on, the automatic transcription anyway. And then I realized, oh my gosh, this is brilliant. I could take this transcription and do so many things with it. It's like, I can repurpose these videos in different ways now that I have the text, the transcription. That's brilliant. If you're not if you're doing videos and you're not doing the automatic transcription, it's the easiest way to add some extra layers of SEO.
But then even one step above that is the description. So taking that transcript and putting it into the actual description of the video text. So where it says like just describing the video, because that really helps out a lot too. You don't have to, if it's like a 30-minute podcast, you might not want to transcribe the whole thing, but you can timestamp it. And those timestamps are just more text, more content. And also it's easy for people, like timestamps are like chapters. Like, let me jump to the section here or here instead of having to listen to the whole 30-minute or an hour-long podcast. And transcribing it might be really, really long and expensive as well.
Yeah, but if Google's doing it for you, at least you can take a chunk out of it and mm-hmm. use that. If you just skim through the transcription, you might be able to find a section of the video that was like, oh, wow, that's really good stuff. Let me take that 2-minute clip and do something with it, which it's a lot easier to skim through text than it is to listen to a podcast over and over again. And I listen to every podcast I record, I listen to at least 3 times. At least 3 times. So I'm done listening after that.
You know the ins and outs of that each episode, then you know where all the times go.
I don't understand. This is a complete tangent. I'm going to go off on a tangent here. There are so many podcast hosts that don't even listen to the episode after it's recorded. They're like, they record it and then they're done. They have somebody else do the editing and then they're done. I'm like, well, that's disingenuous to your guest, right? Mm-hmm. Like, guests mm-hmm. took the, hour out of their day to come and give valuable information to your audience, not even re-listening to the the episode. How are you going to, like, something that I like to do, again, I told you I'm going on a tangent. Something that I like to do is I like to find ways to introduce people to each other. And, if I'm having a conversation with you, I might forget that you said something. And then when I re-listen to the podcast, I'll hear it and I'll go, oh, I should introduce Brandon to so-and-so because they both like such and such, right? And if I don't re-listen, I'm not going to be able to make that connection. And I pride myself on connecting people. It's Kandas Connects. I mean, I do, I do my best to make sure that all the people in my life know each other for some reason or another. I'm that butterfly at parties that goes around and introduces people to each other. Oh, you work in the oil and gas industry. They work in the oil and gas industry. Do you guys know each other?
I like that. Got to connect everyone. We're all connected. We need to stay connected.
Yeah. So what are things about Google that people might not know?
There's a lot. I mean, no one really knows how Google works. That is the big mystery, is how does their algorithm work? Because it's changing every single day. So that is really the big mystery, is what's going on behind the scenes. What are they really looking at? Because they'll tell you little hints of what they're looking at or what they're not looking at. But can you really trust Google? They're not telling the truth. They're going to tell you what they want you to hear, because they want you to only spend money on ads. That's how they make all their money, is off paid ads. So SEO is just there because if Google is just ads, you'd be like, I'm going to go on Bing or Yahoo or another search engine. So they have to have that balance of organic and paid ads. But the big mystery is, how do they work?
I think that they do a pretty good job of separating, or filtering out the bad ads, I guess. I mean, the ads that I see are usually pretty spot on relative to what I'm looking for. And which is, you know, on Facebook, I sometimes get ads that are completely irrelevant to anything that has to do with me. And I look at the ad and I go, why in the world am I getting that ad? You know, but on Google, I don't ever feel that kind of disconnect ever happens. Okay. So what about analytics? I want to share a story, and I hate to get personal about somebody's life, but they've been all over the news, so I'm going to share the story anyway. Many years ago, I decided that it would be really cool if the town that I lived in had a Star Wars festival. And so I threw a Star Wars festival, and there were thousands of people there. There are vendors who came out who sold, you know, their Star Wars art at this festival. And it was a great time. And one of the artists gifted me, I have my background blurred, so I can't point it out right now, but he gifted me a piece of art afterwards. And then I saw him and his wife a couple more times, and then I left Texas. Well, about six months after we moved, I saw on the news or on Facebook or somewhere, that his wife had been murdered in her driveway. And because they had such a huge connection to the Star Wars community, they were part of the 501st Stormtroopers. They had this huge connection to Star Wars. It made national news because of the Star Wars angle. And Peter Mayhew, who was Chewbacca, he donated some money to their foundation to try to find the killer. Well, it's been several years and the killer's never been found. And in that time, you know, this whole true crime genre has taken off, and the story of his wife's murder has been featured in true crime, you know, podcasts and whatnot all over the place. And so my interview with him on my website now is my second biggest, you know, in Google Analytics, you can see how many times a page is shown. Well, it's the second most seen page on my website, but it has two hits. I don't want people coming to my site for that reason. Okay. But the reason I'm telling the story is because I've got this page on my website that is seen by Google a lot, but doesn't have any hits. So if it wasn't related to a story about someone that I knew being murdered, which I don't want to capitalize on, I don't want to promote that. But if it was something that I did want to promote, what are some things I could do to turn those views, you know, those Google hits or Google, whatever they're called, convert them into clicking on the website? And that was a really long roundabout way of getting to the question.
So if people are searching on Google but not clicking on you, either you're ranked too low, or sometimes Google just gives an answer right there. There's a lot of zero click keywords where people just search like, what is the weather? What is the temperature? Or stuff like that. Or like sporting events, like what's the score? And they'll tell you that stuff right there. So
To be fair, I do not want people coming to my website to be ugly about this man who lost his wife, right? But to be fair, that's not the kind of traffic I want. But they're Googling his name and they're finding my website and they're not clicking on the link because it's not related to the murder of his wife. It's related to the art, right? So again, I don't want that traffic. But if it was a word, you know, that I did want the traffic for, it would be about changing the keywords. I mean, what could I do? If I wanted to sell purple widgets and I was, you know, I saw that Google was showing my website for purple widgets, but no one was clicking on it, what are some of the things I could do to change that?
I don't know. The two things you could change are the title tag and the meta description. So when you search on Google, the blue clickable link is a title tag. the black text underneath it, some meta description. That's where you could put more captivating information. I would just search on Google though. I would just search on Google for your keywords and see what other people are using for that blue clickable link, because you're going to see patterns emerging and you're going to see trends, and what everyone else is using is probably what you should be using, unless it's something completely different. But for the most part, you're going to see a lot of overlap in the title tag, the meta description. Well, so the title tag is all keywords. You want to put as many keywords as possible without repeating yourself. Get 60 characters. After that, it gets cut off, that little truncated with the dot, dot, dot. You can make it a little bit longer, but you want to keep it around 60 characters. And meta description, that black text underneath it, just describes what that page is about. So that's where you describe what this page is about in like one or two sentences, and put a call to action at the end. Like for e-commerce, I always tell people, like, put shop now or buy today or free shipping. For mine, like, I'm an SEO company, I'd say like call today for a free consultation. For yours, you could say like listen to this podcast or whatever it may be that you want to, like, whatever you're going to entice people. But putting a call to action, a lot of people don't put that in the meta description, and that's something to help increase click-through rates, because you got to entice people. If you're ranked number 3, you got to entice them to, like, why should they click on yours versus the 2 above you? There might be ads. There's all these other, there's a lot of noise now on Google.
I'm going to switch gears. So a couple of years ago, Google came out with Google Stories. Is that still a thing? Because I didn't really invest in it. Do you know what I'm talking about?
I know it's like Google News is there. I've seen Stories. I'm sure it's still there. I don't think they took it away, but I haven't seen it recently.
So it's not. See, I had a feeling when I saw that it was something that was going to be kind of a fly by night thing. So I never really spent the time to get to know what it was. So we talked about shopping. So Google has a shopping platform. Is that good for SEO to do that?
If you're e-commerce, you want to be on. Yeah, you definitely want to try to get in there, or even for paid ads. Those ads are really effective for Google Shopping, because those ads show a picture of your product versus just like a search on Google is just a website, like just text. But with the shopping ads, it shows the product and it even shows the price, which helps a lot, because now you're not getting people to click onto your website from an ad, see the price and get scared. They see the price right there on the ad. They don't even have to click on the ad. They see the price right there. So they know if it's too expensive or maybe too cheap, and it looks like it might be. Why is it so cheap compared to other people? So pricing it all out, figure that sweet spot out. But Google Shopping is something you definitely want to be a part of. It's called Google Merchant Center. It's where you submit your shopping feed. And Google will even give you sometimes free ads for your Google Merchant Center for e-commerce, which is kind of rare of them.
Is it still free to submit your feed through the Merchant Center? Okay, it's been a while since I've had an e-commerce site. So it's really, if you can invest the time or pay someone like Brandon to do it for you, it's probably a really good idea to make sure that your products are showing up on Google Shopping. All right, what haven't we talked about?
There's so much with SEO. It just depends where you want to go with it. But shopping is important for e-commerce. And I would, yeah, definitely get a shopping, create a shopping feed, submit it to the Merchant Center. You want to run paid ads through it, you can run paid ads, but they'll let you submit it for free. But the paid ads are really cheap compared to normal Google ads. And like I said, it shows the price, which is huge. I mean, normally you don't put the price in an ad, but there you can see exactly how much it costs, and you're not going to get all those wasted clicks from people that are just like, this is too expensive for me.
With Google Shopping, you can have a paid ad and it includes the price, and it's less expensive than Google ads on the search engines.
Yeah, Google search ads. So Google search ads, the way it works is like the more people that bid on the keyword, the more expensive it becomes. So almost everyone is able to just do a keyword-based search or a keyword-based ad saying, I want to rank for like blue widgets. They could just bid on that keyword. And then I could say, I want to bid $5. You could say, I'm going to bid $5.01. And over the past 20 years, it's gone up a lot. Whereas with the Merchant Center, these are people that actually submit their fee to Google Merchant Center, which cuts out probably 80% of the advertisers because they're not doing it. And then once it's there, you might say, and it's newer, so it hasn't been around for as long as Google ads, so it hasn't been bid up as much. So you could probably get away with ads maybe being half as expensive, probably more than that. Even YouTube. YouTube is really nice because Google owns YouTube. They'll give you 30 seconds free ad space on YouTube. So if somebody watches your ad for 29 seconds and then skips it, you don't pay a penny. After 30 seconds, then you pay like 5 or 10 cents a view. I mean, it changes, but that one is even more cost effective. Like the Because then you got to think about how many people are actually creating a YouTube ad. Not many people are doing a video ad. So less people are bidding on these keywords. it's cheaper, but video is the most effective. People want to buy off people. People want, like, everything's really shifted towards video now. Like, Instagram is primarily videos. TikTok is all videos. Pinterest allows videos. All the social media sites now allow videos. So visual content is definitely taking off and something everyone should jump on.
I agree. I didn't realize that Google ads were that inexpensive, the YouTube ads. And can you, like, do a 31-second ad to increase your chances of not having to pay for it? That's my thinking.
Google's like, nope. If your ad's under 30 seconds, then every time somebody watches it, it counts as a view. So that
what's like 45 seconds? No, I'm just kidding. So I just want to add a little video tip. I had this ad recurring on my YouTube channel for weeks until I could find, and she must have either run out of money or whatever, but she was so close to the camera that you could look up her nose, and it was so bad. Such a bad ad. Don't put your face so close to the camera that people can see your nose hairs. Please don't do that.
No. Give a little bit of distance, but I always tell people, don't overdo it too. Like, just take your phone. Don't overthink it. Like, don't make it a big production, because it loses out of authenticity too. It becomes less personable. So just grab your phone or, like, use a gimbal. That's usually the best. Like, have a stand and then just record that video ad, or even, like, you record that video ad, you can put that on your website too, because people's attention spans are really short. If you have a video that you've created a video ad for YouTube, or you have a video, you can put that on your website, because people don't really want to read. Unfortunately, nowadays, if they get to your website and there's just a bunch of text, or even if it's just couple bullet points, they're probably going to skim through it just looking for keywords or things that pop out. But if there's a video that you put on your website, people will most likely watch that video. If they click play and they don't watch it, they'll still listen to it. So they'll hear your message and hear what you have to offer. And it makes it a lot more personable. Kind of puts, like, a face behind the company. I don't say, like, don't use an animation video, but, like, put yourself behind the camera, which a lot of people are scared. They don't want to do it. It's tough for me to do it, but once you do it, it's so easy. And then you realize, I should have been doing this so long ago, because it builds up that trust and it really puts a face behind the company. Instead of just being at a website, you're just like, what is this website? Now it's like, okay, I could see Brandon, or I could see Candace, or whoever is promoting it.
Yeah. And you're right about not fussing so much about what you look like on camera or what the background is on your screen. But my number one rated video on YouTube, I'm a breast cancer thriver. And so my number one rated video on YouTube is a story about when I had my surgery, and it's got, it might be at 40 or 50,000 views at this point. And it's just me sitting in front of my webcam with a messy office behind me talking about talking about my breast cancer surgery. And to this day, about once a week, someone will comment on it. And it's been 8 or 9 years, something like that. So, you know, it's raw, it's real. It's 8 years old and it's still driving traffic. So just don't overthink it. Okay. So I think I already asked you this, but is there anything that I didn't ask you that you want to answer? Is there a question I didn't ask you that you want to answer?
I think we covered a lot, but some of the more important, or one thing, is just, like, patience with SEO. A lot of people are just like, what's going on? Why am I not getting these rankings? And SEO does take time. Unfortunately, it's not just an immediate, like, if you want immediate results, you run paid ads, you get that traction right away. SEO is more of a long-term play. So a lot of people get discouraged and say, I'm not getting these rankings, I'm not moving up in traffic. It's just patience. It takes time. It takes about 6 months to kind of take full effect. But even then, it just depends on competitiveness. Like, how competitive are the keywords you're trying to rank for? If you're trying to rank for, like, something like t-shirts, hyper competitive. Whereas if you're selling something more unique and niche, less competitive, it will rank quicker. It's still going to take time, but just have to understand and be realistic with your goals and just be patient. Cause a lot of people just now, everyone wants instant rule. We want that instant gratification. We want to see these results just jump up, but it all takes time.
Everything takes time. It takes time for everything. It takes time for a pot roast with this, you know, we're an instant gratification society, but the things that are really good and worth it take time. So thank you for sharing that. All right. This is my favorite part of the episode or the interview. Please share your moment of gratitude. For whom or what are you most grateful?
I'm probably just grateful for all the people in my life that have helped me out, Ron, and my family, friends that have all supported me, but, like, mentors and things like that, where they've helped me in growing my personal and business life, because without others, you could learn it all, but it just takes a lot more time and it's a lot easier to have a support team or ask for help. Definitely recommend everyone should get a mentor. That's going to really help out as your business just grows and speed up things and help you learn from their mistakes and try to avoid some of those mistakes. That way you don't have to have the same issues that they had in the past.
Thanks for joining us this week for Gratitude Geek, the relationship marketing podcast, helping micropreneurs find your micro influencer magic. Your time is valuable, and I am ever so grateful that you chose to spend your time with us today. Be sure to check the show notes at gratitudegeek.com, episode 126, for links to all the groovy resources mentioned today, and of course, to connect with Brandon Leibowitz. And while you're there, why not subscribe to the show on Audible, iTunes, Stitcher, or any of your favorite podcast players. Our theme music is Track 14 by Rev Brock and Soul Lily. I've been your host, Kandas Rodarte. Join me on my mission to spread gratitude, sow seeds of appreciation, and harvest a bounty of generosity and kindness. Stay groovy, my friends.
Stay groovy, my friends.